responsible for the outbreak of this revolt of 1789 of such a magnitude? To answer these questions, one should have a holistic approach which should cover the key areas, and for the sake of understanding and clarity, I've segmented the causes of the French Revolution into three main phases. The first one being the characters. By characters, we mean who was mainly responsible for the outbreak of the French Revolution. Then the second issue is on what transpired. So what transpired, this I just referring to the general causes of the revolution, which can be interpreted as economic, social, as well as political factors. Then lastly, but not least, is the issue of the events, right? The event, which event can we pinpoint as the major starting point for this furor which occurred in 1789. So we can start by the first part that include the characterization, the characters who played a pivotal role in accelerating or influencing this revolt of 1789. In terms of characters, we can have the king, Louis XVI, at the apex as the chief travel causer and culprit who influenced the outbreak of this revolution, followed by the queen, Mary Antoinette, who also had an enormous part to play in the outbreak of the revolution. Then thirdly, we also have the bourgeois, we have the nobility, right? The nobility, then the revolutionaries themselves, who were the head estate in France. So these various groupings of people played their part, though in varying degrees, to the outbreak of the French Revolution. As for King Louis XVI, his character should be brought under spotlight. Some historians even argue that the revolt of 1789 could not have occurred if it was not for the incompetent character of the king. The Louis XVI exhibited gross incompetence in carrying out his duties, his royal duties to be specific. This is largely because Louis XVI, he was said to have a vacillating character. Right? By a vacillating character, we mean that the king was very timid and naive. Right? So, right? So in this case, we are saying the timidity of the king is shown by lack of confidence and courage in carrying out his activities. As even Dennis Richards comments that Louis XVI was a king in name and in power. And he was a king in name and in power, but not in character. Right. Then it comes also to the issue of his naivety. Naivety in this case means he lacked the political maturity. So there was some bit of political immaturity in the king, Louis XVI. This is largely because he was mainly interested in hunting rather than in carrying out his royal duties. So, in more often than not, the king failed to deliver his expected prerogative, largely because he spent much of his time hunting instead of administering the state. Then, secondly, there's the issue of the king being weak-willed. The king was weak-willed because of his inconsistency. He initiated reforms but failed to carry them to the final end. So in between, the king could be found being a flip-flop. developer at one point of time, the king could have realized the gravity of the economic problems in France, which would be driving the society, and he tasked some able and competent finance ministers, such as Turgot, such as Necker, Calonn, and Brienne. But however, the king was either negatively influenced by the queen due to the petticoat government and petticoat politics, or by the ambitious nobility who were anxious to cling to their privileges. So eventually we see that the need to bring about some reforms was greatly affected by the weak-willed character, as the king suddenly made some U-turns at a time when he was supposed to be consistent in terms of policy making. Then thirdly, we see that Louis XVI was also characterized by the issue of a casual approach. The king had lacked seriousness and solemnity in carrying out his duties because of his casual approach to serious matters which were affecting the Frenchmen. This was likely because sometimes Louis XVI failed to understand the gravity of the problems which were affecting his people. So, thus, the economic problems had reached a crisis point, and the king was supposed to stem his authority by making sure that the plight affecting his subjects was alleviated. But alas, the king's casual approach resulted in him failing to implement reforms in time, saying that by 1789 it was already too late, making the revolt inevitable. On top of that, one should also realize that the king, in terms of the issue of timidity, he easily succumbed to the negative advice of those surrounding him, especially the aristocrats, namely the queen and the ambitious nobility. Dennis Richards quoted one of Louis XVI's royal advisors called Mirabeau, saying, "There is only one man about the king, that man is the queen." So the king's character necessitated the unwise intervention of the queen, who usually made some emotional decisions which were not good to tackle the problems which were bedeviling the French society. At one point of time in 1789, in what became known as the October March of Women, it was the king who failed to stem his authority, leading to the intervention of the queen, who responded to the hungry Parisian mob requesting for bread by saying, "Let them eat cake." Now this destroyed all hopes of reforms, and this also demonstrated the inconsiderate character of the monarch, which was personified by the king himself, since he was the person who was at the helm of the French political party. So bearing this in mind, we see that the king exhibited this gross incompetence, which provided a leeway for the Frenchmen to revolt. The Frenchmen could have revolted earlier, since most of the problems were long-standing, but probably because Louis XIV and Louis XV had a strong personality, such that they had efficient despotism, unlike Louis XVI, who claimed to be a despot, yet he lacked the adequate machinery to implement despotic powers. Lastly, but not least, is the issue again of the despotic character of the king. Louis XVI himself had inherited the ancient regime, which was characterized by despotism and absolutism. This demonstrated that all power and authority was vested in the hands of the king. So it was the king who almost occupied every influential decision making in the French society. According to Dennis Richards, Louis XVI was even quoted saying, "There is the whole state is myself. The thing is legal because I wish it." So this demonstrated that the king's word was the law, and he was above the law. Such despotic tendencies could no longer apply change of times, since the majority of the Frenchmen who were the bourgeoisies were already enlightened. The Enlightenment era and the philosophical teachings had created a revolutionary spirit, yet the king failed to realize that he was supposed to relax his despotic tendencies so that he can yield to some political reforms, since the Third Estate, especially the educated bourgeoisies who were philosophized by those by the Enlightenment era, were now demanding some changes. A case in point is that of the Estate General Meeting, where the king was supposed to make a firm decision by reforming, especially the voting system. But alas, the king now suggests votic tendencies were now used to crash down the demands of the majority by entertaining the interests of only a few elites who were the nobility. So by so doing, the revolt of 1789 was made inevitable. So having said that, time could not have allowed us to cover all aspects about the French Revolution, because we've got still a lot to cover: the Queen's character, the nobility, and the Third Estate. But as of now, we can conclude this lesson by saying that this is one of the most vexatious topics in A-level history, and students should be well versed as to which part are they answering. Are you answering, is the question about characters, is the question about the general causes, or is the question pertaining to the events? So I think last year but one, the question was on the role of the aristocratic revolt. So that means it was about events. So most students tend to have a machine gun approach, where they just want to field everything that they think of without paying meticulous attention to the demand of the question. So my name is Mr. Swazwa. Stay tuned for the next session. God bless you. Thank you.